Well, 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 welcome back to Crown's Crypto Cave. It's a lovely hump day over here from a, once again, extremely dark and gritty Helsinki, Finland, recording this video before the ripe old hour of 7 a.m., which is the power time. Anyways, just made that up. Anyways, plenty to talk about today as we do a follow-up on yesterday's short-term time frame analysis, getting that downside move that we spoke about, hitting a few of the short-term time frame targets, but is it all done? I don't know about that. So fucking dumb. Anyways, what else do we want to talk about? Also want to follow up on the long-term time frame analysis as well. And with that said, I want to wish you the best of best and the happiest. And now let's get down and deep and dirty into this magic internet money over here. Anyways, looking at Bitcoin dominance, shooting up about 0.5% from yesterday to today, hanging just below 63%, of which that would suggest when Bitcoin is playing a little bit of a red dildo party, then it is time for altcoins to not have the best time of all time. We'll call it that. Anyways, more importantly, what does that suggest? Well, Bitcoin technically is ranging right now, and if altcoins are actually not going to be benefiting during that ranging period, then we do have a little bit of an end of the rotations going on that we were seeing before. Before the whole kind of feeling of the market was Bitcoin moves, altcoins kind of lose versus the Satoshi pair, then Bitcoin goes sideways, then they gain a little bit back, and then rinse repeat up until almost $20,000. Now we're seeing a little bit of a change of behavior right there. Now I'd want to see this sustained for a little bit longer, maybe another week or two, before I really start to dig deeper into that. But we are starting to see some different things going on right here. Open interest hanging just above 3 billion once again. Still kind of within that same range. I wouldn't really define the range just yet. I do think that we have a top side of it, obviously, 19,550 correlated with about 3.25 billion. But other than that, we haven't really been able to make too much out of that. And I see a lot of people making a mountain out of a molehill with the open interest. Yes, open interest is very, very important and does help round out a well-rounded analysis. But the thing is that I see a lot of people going down onto like a fucking 4 hour and judging the open interest there, like correlated with price action. And that's just like, not how it's designed. Realistically, it should be used on nothing less than a daily time frame. Anyways, fear and greed index also coming down quite significantly there. What relatively speaking, we'll say from a 95 to an 86. And let's into the data tab we go. And what is revealed by these canaries? Once again, we do see, yes, coming down to the low side of the fear and greed index node, the extremely greedy zone right here, of which we spent a little bit more than 1 month within the extreme greedy zone between about 85 and 95, of which that was some of the highest reads that we've seen over the last few years, in fact, and now coming down. So if we could reference the historical valuation of this, we would actually be able to see that the last time that Bitcoin was even in the 90s was, I believe, in 2017, 2018. And typically speaking, you know, while it does denote, hey, cautionary times, it's not really till it comes back down below alongside price action with a reversal on at the very least a daily, where we do start to define local highs. Anyways, into the funny rate tab we go. What do we see right here? Nothing really out of the ordinary except for FTX posting a negative 0.05% funny rate right there. I'd want to double check if that's correct, because we have had some issues with our data feed. But if that is correct, then that's just a little bit bizarre, because everyone else is hanging around 0.01% except for OKX, which is 0.02%, which doesn't really give us anything, any other edges to be looking at right here. So with that said, it's time to go into the actual price action charts themselves, and we'll start it off with the secondary chart once again today. And I want to focus in on CME price action right here. The reason why is because I just think it's a more obvious chart, obviously, you know, more obviously speaking. Anyways, bringing up the momentum oscillators right here, I do want to talk about a few major things that could happen today that are going to drive targets lower. So while Bitcoin did hit our short-term downside target at, first 18.7 yesterday, then taking out that area, which begot that next continuation phase to 18.250, which is kind of, actually we're a little bit below that right now. But overall, yes, I do think that this likely has a little bit more low to go. However, if Bitcoin does this one thing by the end of the day today on CME closure, then I'm going to start to extend those targets a lot more. And what would that be? That would be a daily dodo closure below the 20 cent moon average right here. If that happens in conjunction with the ADX DMI starting to strengthen while the DMI minus is starting to get dominant, which to be fair right now, it is still, you know, relatively far away. And I'm actually using incredibly aggressive settings with this right here. In fact, I should really raise it up to about a 24 as referenced on the DMI video that I released last week. I think it was last week. Yeah, it was, I think, end of last week. We should actually be adding more videos to that playlist soon enough. In fact, I'm postulating a new video for that one that's going to be like the biggest, the fucking silliest mistakes that I see new traders making, because now I've been like, I've been watching a lot of people, myself included, over the last 3 years, myself obviously longer, but over the last 3 years, I've actually had the pleasure of watching other people go through the journey. And I can successfully say now there's like a few major things that I see, some like I can almost immediately tell if someone's going to be on the right track or not. So I think I'll do a video on that just because, well, hopefully people find it fucking valuable. Anyways, so yes, you know, if we do see both a daily total closure below the 20-minute average right here, plus the DMI minus getting dominant, maybe over a 23, perhaps a 24 would be a little bit better here, but it is, you know, it is kind of showing a little bit of weakness, then yes, I would actually be targeting moves back down to the prior low of this current structure, which would bring Bitcoin somewhere back down around the low side of the bottom side 200 band, which is in line actually with those prior lows at about mid to low $16,000. So with that in mind, I do think that this can get significantly extended to the downside, but I want to reiterate and I want to be incredibly clear with this. All higher term timeframes for me are still bullish here. I will not switch around to looking for like significant, well, significant is in the eye of the beholder now, isn't it? Because this is quite significant, at least in my opinion, but I wouldn't look for a greater reversal here, you know, be getting targets down to 14,000 or 15,000 as long as this one condition is met. And that is Bitcoin putting in higher lows on the daily. And where's our last low right here? Well, it's 17,000 bucks about. So as long as we're closing daily totals above there, I don't really, you know, have any major gripes with price action except for playing within the greater range right here, which, yes, is about a $3,000 range. However, still would have a bullish bias long term. I want to reference the weekly, still, you know, more or less fine right here. I don't see anything, you know, wrong with this chart. If we go over here to the monthly, same thing, still bullish on the monthly chart. By the way, are we testing the topside Toronto band on the monthly? No, it's actually at a low $17,000 region. Obviously, it will be, you know, adhere to the current price action. So, you know, when Bitcoin was trading right around 20,000 bucks, it was actually kind of it was still a little bit lower than where we are right now. I think it was like mid $17,000. Now it's come down to about 17 even, but you can imagine that it can wildly change before the end of the month here. So, still within the same vicinity is what I'm trying to say. And if we go to the bi-monthly, same shit. If we go to the quarterly, same shit as well, but we've already seen this a million goddamn times, so I don't really feel the need to do that right now. But my point is right now is that yes, Bitcoin on all higher term timeframes, I still do remain bullish on it, especially as long as Bitcoin is putting in higher lows on the daily. And for reference, again, that is the 17,150 closure right here. Pretty much the same shit on CMEs as well. Yeah, 17.2, same, close enough is close enough in this case. And in overall, as long as that condition is met, I'm just generally bullish, and I'd be looking to potentially even get into a long-term position I don't know about relatively soon, but you know, the same areas that we've been speaking about for the last few weeks here. So I do start to feel a little bit more vindicated in my patience here, even after a lot of very interesting and profound comments. It's very interesting to see like some comments where like in the same video, someone will say, "Crown, you're way too bullish. You've sold out. You're terrible." and then in the same fucking video, that someone else will say, "Crown, you're too fucking bearish. You've sold out. You're terrible." It's like, okay, so maybe I could do a better job with expressing myself. Maybe that is, maybe that is an issue, but hopefully it's clear to most people. I do trust that, you know, the average person is a reasonable person, and all is well and good. Anyways, looking at this right here, let's follow from yesterday's short-term time frame analysis, of which we did say a move down to the 18.8 base was likely. We saw that, and we did also say that that would start to really make this look like a descending triangle with three or actually four confirmed local highs. Lower highs, not local highs, although they were local highs as well at the time, that is. 1, 2, 3, and 4. And then boom, downside move, of which the mesh move is going to be right under 18,000 bucks. And you could say that Bitcoin's gotten pretty close to that so far. I think that it does have a little bit more of a downside move to go. But the downside break is legitimate here, yes. And I would essentially be short-term bearish as long as we are below the 18.8 pivot, just as we said yesterday. So, you know, while there probably is maybe even a short-term bounce, like an extremely short-term bounce off this 18,250-ish region in line with what we see over here on spot price action with the 618 Fibonacci retracement, I mean, you can even say that maybe we already have seen that. I do think that it's very, 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 very likely that this bounce gets sold into. I do think that Bitcoin's extremely likely to actually test the lower levels of this. if the 786 was sold and we do have formation also breaking down, then the bot and algo target is going to be down around actually the not, at least a 0.5, which you could say that we've gotten very, very close thus far. It's technically at 17.9. So, you know, at least another swipe down there. But it's the way that price action is looking right here, it looks a lot more likely that the 382 will get tested, which is in the mid $17,000 region. I do think that it has the potential to be a reversal point that would obviously be on higher lows on the daily as well. And if this area does fail, then I'd go to the next one, which is 17,150 at the 236. However, that's a lot more of a nastier one. If Bitcoin fails this level, then it's time to really consider that this actually is a major reversal here. It still probably takes some time, and I'd be looking at short-term bounces at the very least off of all these levels, actually playable bounces in fact too. But if, you know, it would start to imply that the higher term time frame resolution is going to be to the downside, and we can explore those lower targets. But still, I don't think that it's relevant for me. I don't think it's not that it's not relevant. Of course, everything's relevant in some aspect, but I don't think that it's appropriate for me to really talk about like extreme low side targets just yet, as long as we're operating off of higher lows on the daily. Doesn't mean that it can't happen. It's just, I'm not going to talk about it until that condition is met, because then these videos are going to be too fucking long. And realistically, I mean, the same levels that were relevant on the way up are going to be relevant on the way down. You're going to see 15,000 and then like upper $13,000 region, low $14,000 region. Those would be the two next major ones that I want to have on tap. But again, you know, long ways to actually confirm that. And we are dealing with, again, big numbers here. So, you know, Bitcoin can travel another $1,000 to the downside and still remain in an overall uptrend on the daily. In fact, even a little bit more than that. That's kind of my point right now, is that myself as a trader, I just don't switch around my opinion until these sorts of more hard conditions are met. And that's just, you know, that's just stuff that I've learned from my past to keep me safe in what is, you know, pretty aggressively trending markets here. Although we are going through a more intensive consolidation, we'll call it. Anyways, I want to call this out one more time, and I want to give credit again to the person who actually called it out in the Discord, Mr. EO, for the cross between the 200 simple and 200 exponential average on the 4-hour delta time frame, because it does line up with that further target to the downside. And if I did have to call it right now, yes, I do think that it will get hit. That is a 382 right here at 17,500, also a historical horizontal coming in from our last breakout and actually breakdown on the other side. More importantly with that, we do see that anytime we see the 200 simple cross the upside of the 200 exponential average, price action typically does kind of act like a magnet towards it. Works both ways, of course. We do see the inverse of this happening right in over here. Price action gets sucked into them and then spit back out. Same thing over here. We see a cross and this one on the same side as the one that we're looking at right now. Let me just make sure that I'm recording. Okay, I'm recording. The microphone's working. That's really good. and yes, you know, price action gets sucked into it. The 200 exponential average actually does play out a nice bounce. Doesn't mean that it's, you know, it's always going to reverse like that. To be fair, same thing over here. We do see them crossing right here. Price action gets sucked back down. Nice. Same thing over here. Sucked up. Same thing over here. Sucked up. Suck it right on up, girl. And sorry, couldn't help myself. And same thing over here. Same thing over here. You know, you get the idea. My point is that these levels would be confluent with other targets that we are seeing a little bit lower, based off the Fib retracements, based off historical horizontals. And I'm sure if we did throw on a volume profile, there's probably something coming in this region as well. It's just zero in on this consolidation as it is. And yes, there we go. We do see a little bit of a higher value node in the general context of this price action, where basically where the 200 simple and 200 exponential average are probably going to be rising up towards over the next day and a half. So I do think that it's, you know, it's relatively likely that Bitcoin does come down around here and very likely does play out at the very least a short-term bounce here, maybe likely even a medium-term bounce as well. The key critical thing, though, is do we start to close, you know, well, especially 4 hours below that region, then that's going to be your next major warning signal saying prepare for another $500 move to the downside, likely towards about 17,150 pivot right here. And that's kind of like the last chance for love as far as the greater formation goes. Of course, it's probably going to take its time regardless of which way that this one prints. But for right now, for right now, it would start to really change the general disposition on this formation if we were to break this level right here, because then, you know, Bitcoin's likely to come back down to its prior low. And then how can you have higher lows when you come in back down to your prior low? Doesn't make sense now, does it? Now, of course, you can't have a rectangular consolidation as well. But in this case right here, you know, it's going to have a chance to put in what would be a reaccumulation formation. The question is, where does Bitcoin try to attempt to put in a higher low? And if that fails, then we have a reversal. And it's time to talk about, you know, much lower price action, although I'm not necessarily thinking in that direction. You know, the criteria that is set out for it is very, 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 very clear. So I hope that that's all well and good. And I'm short-term bearish as long as you're below about 18.7 pivot. And I mean, we could even say the 618 right now at 18.250. I do believe that the next closure below, or just even regardless of whether we close below or not, is going to at the very least test once again towards 17.9, and then preferably this level down here. That's where I start to get very interested in trying positions out, not because it's guaranteed to work out, but because I do like the edge on those trades and it makes risk management incredibly easy. And this is not financial advice. I'm not a financial advisor. And we're not on the TA Nerd session just yet. So have to be careful here, huh? Have to be careful. Anyways, we haven't even gone through the low term time frame momentum oscillators, but first and foremost, we did see the expansion on historic volatility percentile that we're looking for coming into yesterday. We did say a move extremely likely within the next 24 hours. And we're getting that. So you can kind of see in front of your very eyes how this does work. Now here's the next question for me though. We actually don't see the moving average switching into an upwards slope here just yet. And if that's going to be the case, then what could actually be going on if we draw a regression through here is we actually are still within the context of a greater contraction phase. I want to see it actually break above this kind of regression, which is not too scientific to begin with. I'm just trying to, you know, measure out what the, you know, what it would look like. But I really want to see the moving average on this get a positive slope while it does get above that region. That would be good for going into a full-on expansion phase, and in that case, you know, I'd really want to be paying attention to overall direction, because that's likely to just beget continuation. So in this case right here, that likely does mark off the next potential low, if you will. And even if you're bullish or bearish, no matter if you're bullish or bearish, the next, you know, local low within the context of a fucking $3,000 range, I mean, that could be, you know, $1,000 or $2,000 trade right there. So, you know, fair enough. I'm very, very interested in such things. We can go to the 3-hour as well. We see the same thing, and this one is certainly getting a positive slope right there. So that would be a good sign that we will see something like this. Same thing with the bi-hourly right here. Same thing with the hourly right here. In fact, a lot more intensive, but the hourly a little bit less relevant to the 4-hour, obviously. But more importantly, yes, it is. It is going into an expansion phase already. So that is good. Suggesting that we are going to see further falling first on this price action, actually. Very, very likely we do head a little bit further south at the very least, 17.9. Personally speaking, I think 17.5 is rather likely. And then if all else fails, 17.150 is the last chance for love. we didn't really go over momentum oscillators. Let's go over the 4-hour right here. What do we see? 4-hour stokes getting way down there. Here's what actually be needed to turn them back on the upside. Yeah, it's following the trend right now. So as long as we're below that 18.7 pivot, good to go for some more downside. 3-hour showing, same thing as well. Downside, bi-hourly down, hourly down, or sorry, hourly actually kind of flip-flopping around, but we see them all on the same side. So that's usually what I'm really looking for. And in this case right here, what I would be saying about that is that while there is likely another move to the downside, I do think that you know, it wouldn't really take too much to get all those popped back onto the upside as well. So I would keep a keen eye on that, because the next time that you do see them all line up for the upside here too, that's probably going to be your next bounce attempt. And while, yeah, short term is still suggesting downside here, I would be on high alert again in the mid, especially in the mid $17,000 region and even the low $17,000 region, at the very least for a short term bounce. I mean, like I've been saying, for short term, whether you're bullish or bearish, high probability of bounces within that region. I think also if we go in reference Caretaker's Magic over here, yeah, we are getting targets actually down towards 17.5 right now, actually, but it, you know, it's telling you to sell like 18,850 right here too. So obviously that trend's passed, and you really want to, you know, get on the actual fucking trend side first, the sell side first, and then go on the other side. However, in this case, we do see that is a confluent actor here too. Anyways, 4-hour, what did we see? We see 4-hour RSI actually losing a little bit of its luster here. This is not a death sentence in and of itself. It can certainly come down a little bit further, but I do not want to see it take out the last low right here on the 26th of November. Here's where that actually is. Yeah, that actually is our last low at 16.5 here as well. So we would be looking for potentially divergence plays here too. What about 3-hour? 3-hour RSI doing same thing. What about bi-hourly? Come on, bi-hourly. There we go. Same thing. And hourly. And I imagine it's going to be the same thing as well. Indeed it is. So yes, we don't see any divergence plays as it is just yet, not even on a fucking hourly. So this is this still a bit more venom to the downside. And we have a death cross on the hourly moving averages, so we know that we're going to fucking zero right now too. course, kidding. But my point is that, hey, you know, this is still, you know, short term, a little bit more downside here. I don't think that Bitcoin has any real reason to stop here except for a short term pop up, of which I think that we've already seen that actually. I think we've already seen that. Also, medium-term timeframes. Let's follow up on this. So this is why I only care about CME signals, especially for something like the Jewel, because yes, it does take a little bit of patience, or a lot of patience, especially referencing the Jewel chat room. However, you know, when you do get these signals, like we got on the 4th of December at 1 a.m. my time, which was, where is that? That would be right here. So not the ultimate high. And this is typically what the Jewel does. This is typically what the Jewel does. It does not get the ultimate high. That's why I'm always very, 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 very skeptical when it does print on an actual high. It probably doesn't play out. And I believe we saw that on spot price action. I said, hey, yes, this does look like a good signal, but this is not what we're really looking for. We got it right here on the lower high. That's what it's trying to do. It's trying to get like the first kind of flip of trend. And then what happens after that? I mean, as you can see, it's taken 5 days post signal to actually start to really play out. You know, yes, that technically did happen on CME. Is it about 19.6? I'm curious what spot was trading at during that time. Yeah, right here at 19.4. So it, you know, that first sort of move down towards 18.9 or 19,000 was like a $400, $500 move. But you're really looking for the break of structure here, and that's what we've gotten thus far. So to date, it looks like it's been about a little, almost a $2,000 signal thus far. Yeah, going at 19.7 right there, all the way down to almost 18,000 even right here. Getting close, I suppose maybe a little more like $1,500 signal. I do think that has a little bit more on it. And if we're just looking at the 12-hour structure right here, I mean, the 55 is going to be a pretty natural target. And I wouldn't really look for a stop on this run until the 12-hour Jewel on CME starts to really get around the next fib somewhere in this region right here. So a little bit more downside. We see all of the all of the moving parts have a negative slope right now. So yeah, I do believe that this one does have another leg to the downside. And I'm sure that the next big topic of conversation is, but Crown, where is my gap fill? How, wow, will I know when my gap is filled? Well, when it's coming out of your mouth is when you know that it's filled. And looking at it right here, you know, there's a couple different ways to be doing this. I say that the most aggressive way is just going wick to wick. It doesn't need to be exact, by the way, either. But in this case right here, that still suggests a little bit more downside in line with the 21 on CMEs, which is in the upper $17,000 region. And then the next, and the kind of like the more obvious way would be going wick to closure. So in this, or sorry, wick to open in this case. You know, I just want to see like the thick part of the body, which would be 17.2. So again, that kind of begets our targets anyways in the mid to low $17,000 region. You know, accounting for the premium over spot price action. And here we go, back down below 18,100. There we go, baby. But let's go through momentum oscillators on the 12-hour here too. 12-hour Stokes, nice and healthily down. Nice. 12-hour RSI, a little bit of nosediving behavior right there. Still in a contraction phase on HVP here too. So I'd look for that to kind of denote the greater resolution of this whole formation. So you can see that we're probably going to spend a lot of time within this region between about 17,000 bucks and 20,000 bucks in long term. Again, long term, spending time between that region at the prior, around the prior all-time highs is actually really fucking good. But once we start to break the higher low structure as it is, then we got some big problems. And then we can talk about, you know, greater reversals. But again, I'm just not on that topic of conversation until we actually get there. So, you know, you will hear me turn around to be massively bearish if that does happen. But it's just, it's still a little bit too far away for me to put some words on that. And I fear that I get misheard a lot, especially in these sorts of contexts of the market, because I'd rather err on the side of the current trend, and I'd rather be more conservative in these regions because, as we showed, the higher term timeframes are still more or less good. Looking at daily Stokes, crumbing to the downside here as well, a little bit of a fake out. That is usually going to be a more nasty signal. So in that case, I would be looking for this one to come, you know, a little bit further down. Yes. So we're just seeing more and more and more things suggesting more short-term downside. Looking at the two-day, what do we see right here? Currently on the 10 symbol, but what does spot price action look like? Yeah, it's actually breaking it pretty significantly. Next major region is going to be the 21, rising up somewhere in the low $17,000 region, it looks like. in the 3 day, this is also another chart that I want to spend a little bit more time on. So we do have potential bearish, regular bearish divergence in play right here. Now, when I see bearish divergence between, you know, a structure that looks like this, it's usually not a really dastardly payoff from those signals. And technically speaking, it's not confirmed just yet. It will be confirmed, I guess. Do we close this one tonight? Now, tomorrow, 7 p.m. Eastern time, anywhere below last open, yeah, 18.7, same pivot again, then yes, you know, I would be looking for a drive again lower. But this sort of signal right here typically doesn't really get a good, good payoff. Obviously, it's relevant to the context of the time frame, so a 3 day is going to have, you know, a big range naturally. But as you can see, the easy part of this move's certainly already played out. So it's really not that useful. You know, you have to be aggressive on those ones, and I just don't trade like that. Some people certainly do, and, you know, you've been rewarded. If you were waiting for the last 3 day low to get taken out, then I guess you got about $1,000 trade right there. Or sorry, maybe not, actually not even close to $1,000 trade, more like a $500 trade. So fair enough. It's not, you know, not it, my point is that it's too hard to play. What's very interesting here though, is that we are starting to see the positive slope on historical volatility percentile. So this expansion phase is a big deal here. And it's actually a lot different than the last one that we saw in July from 9,000 to 12,500, because the moving average was not having a positive slope as well. In fact, it was negatively sloped the whole way through. And as you can see, that rally was spit out relatively soon after that, to be fair. What this signal is more similar to is actually this one back on over here in February 2020, where Bitcoin put in a few multiple low reads in the single digits in this segment right here, then started to expand. And that was this massive move from 10,000 all the way down to about 4,000. The time before that we had something similar was back and over here, this time to the upside in March 2019, and boom, that was your major massive move from 4,000 to, you know, 14,000 over time. And then obviously we got this one over here at 6,000 to 3,000. You know, you get the idea. Anyways, my point is that the expansion phase from this current area right here is going to be really fucking big. You know, if it comes to the downside, it would certainly not be out of question to look for targets to, you know, 15,000 for sure, but 14,000 is certainly on the menu as well. And to the upside, I mean, we could start to talk about targets towards, you know, 23,000 and beyond. But as you know, as we did noted earlier, just like a full on reversal here isn't necessarily, you know, the major topic of conversation just yet, but it's getting fucking close. The upside resolution for this formation is similar to what we spoke about, is no longer super relevant for the short term either here, as long as Bitcoin's below 19,550. There's not really a breakout to be spoken about to the top side. Still, if Bitcoin were to do that, I'd have the same targets as before. We have the measure move off of this formation, which would be pointed towards the 2.272 fib extension right here, just below 23,000 bucks. So really good confluence between those two, and I'd have a keen eye on the 2 spot right here and the 1.414 as short-term stops. But yes, I would be looking for basically 23,000 if that condition was to be met, but that's just not what is relevant today, right? Just not what's relevant today. Okay, 27 minutes into this bitch, and let's get on to MicroStrategy. Yes, and this was the big tell yesterday too. So I remember we went over this yesterday and we said, hey, we are at long-term historical resistance. Let's just pull it back on out, going all the way back to literally 2000. So this is a big deal right here. And this is your major change of behavior, by the way, as well. I mean, we do see like a just humongous drop off after this 350 level was let go. So same thing over here, you know, it's going to get respected very likely. And what do you know, we do have a little bit of a gap fill to come back down towards in the 275-ish region. So yeah, I do think that I do feel vindicated by that call yesterday as well. Yes, I do think that we come a little bit further down here and play out a move somewhere around here. Does it put in a higher low on this rally? Perhaps yes. I'd like to give it a chance first, but short term still would be down. We can also look at GBDC here too. I don't know if I even have it on my list anymore. GBDC, where are you, little piece of shit? I found you, you little shit fuck. Oh wow, weekly looks like a real reversal here. That's problematic. Not certainly not as easy of a chart to read, but short term, yeah, would be suggesting a little more downside here, just below 1990. Yeah, just below 1990 it looks like. But a lot more of a difficult chart to read, to be fair. I'd be looking for a bounce off that level, most likely. But I don't feel as confident on this chart as I do on MicroStrategy. Okay, what about NASDAQ? Where are we at on the traditional markets right now? Or should I just add that to the Maybe I should just keep that on the forex videos and make that a forex and traditional land video. But yeah, looking at this right here, new all-time highs, as we said yesterday, and I still am overall looking towards a targeted region of 13,150-ish. However, short-term, I mean, I don't really have anything new to add. I'm just bullish here. I'm bullish until I'm not bullish. Maybe a short-term move to the downside if it wants to 12.6, but long-term, medium-term, still bullish. Even short-term, still bullish here too. I don't see anything really, really wrong with this chart except for maybe short-term moves to the downside, but I imagine that those get bought back on up. And long-term, as long as it's above this last pivot right here at about 12.450, I'm just looking for that next major target to the upside to get hit. Same thing I imagine with SPY. Yes, what do you know? We have new all-time highs. Craziness going on right here. And that measure move is still pointed north towards the two spot 272 at just above 3,800, it looks like. So, you know, I'm still bullish on basically all markets. Short term, could it come back down? No, this one's bullish on the short term as well. So short term, medium term, long term, all bullish. It's fucking bullish, perhaps. Anyways, you know, does this bode well for Bitcoin? Typically, yes, but these ones typically do move first as well. If we go over here and check out the tech sector, I'm curious how they did yesterday. Yeah, looking like it's still kind of struggling below its last prior all-time high, but it is gearing up for a move here. It looks like it's probably going to be the next one to do it. We do see historic volatility percentile incredibly low at the top side of a long-term range. If it does start to break above that, well, what do we have? We have a bullish reaccumulation formation in the form of an ascending triangle, plus measure moves and Fib extensions all the way up to 137.75. So not bad there as well. Anyways, what else do we want to check out? Is it time to check out LINK? Did we hit our, I believe that we said if Bitcoin breaks down, we'd be looking for about 10.5 bucks. Nope, we haven't hit there just yet. We did hit the short-term target at 11.5, fair enough, but I'd probably be looking for it to tumble a little bit further towards 10.5 if Bitcoin slides to the downside here too. How's the weekly looking like? Still long term is fine. Sideways within this region between about 9.5 and 16.5 is, you know, is long term good, I suppose. But that's long term. I mean, probably not very many people are willing to wait for, you know, the like the half year to a year for that one. What else do we got? I'm curious what the Bitcoin pairing is looking like. I'm guessing it's not so good. We did say that there's a death cross on the daily impending, and yes, it's going to be confirmed very likely today. In fact, I'd already say that this one's pretty much in trouble, as we've been saying, and the next major target is going to be down towards, I think, 54 or 53,000 Satoshis. Come on, show it to me, you weekly fuck. Yeah, there we go. 54,500 Satoshis, in fact. What about Cardano? Oh, no. Another lower high. How could this be on my Cardano's? Is that hidden bearish divergence alongside that? Oh my bunghole is bleeding again. Why do you do this to me? Who made this one? Is it Charles? Why do you do this to me, Charles? I've been such a good boy holding my Cardano's. And look, Sleeping Beauty's up once again. So, good morning. Oh, that was so nice. Great. Okay, so, yeah, shitty charts typically beget more shitty chart movements. Oh, no. Another local high? Fuck. It's almost as if a chart that's making lower highs over multiple years is going to put in another lower high. What the fuck is this? Wake up, neighbors. Cardano's going down again. It's been going down for 3 years, but this time it's different. And wrecked. Let's go check out. Okay, my neighbors are actually woken up right now. Hello, neighbors. Welcome to Crown's Crypto Cave, where you too can receive red dildos in the morning. good to meet you. sorry, they probably don't speak English, so it doesn't matter. They probably do speak English, but they're Finnish, so they're not going to say anything. just the truth. Uni. Okay, so definitely won't finish that one. What about Buterol versus Bitcoin? No! Fuck! Lower highs? This can't be. This can't be. I had my falling fucking pizza over here. Are you telling me that one of the least efficacious patterns is going to fail me once again? God damn it. TA is a scam. I see this shit all the fucking time. It's like, no, it's just you're looking at garbage. Falling pizzas, not the pattern to play in Bitcoin land. Yeah, I still stick with what I've been saying for a long time. Full retraces incoming, sirs. What about B-roll versus dollar? Probably good, but short-term reversal here. That's looking like a lot more of a spinning top on the highs. Short-term, does it come down towards 535, as we said yesterday? It's gotten pretty fucking close, to be fair. 543 already. Doesn't really have too much more room to fuck around in this region before it does start to create lower lows. This could be a little bit of a canary in the coal mine here. If you start to see it take out 520 on a daily closure before Bitcoin, would appear a little bit more easy to do on Buterol. But do we say anything? My Buterols are fucked. Feedlick would never do this to me. Or what is his name? the guy with the Buterols. And yeah, let's see, what about do we even want to do this? Spit your rally back out, you ripple fuckers. There'll be none of this today. They'll be long term it's probably fine, but there'll be more pain. Anyways, back onto Bitcoin. Let's start to wrap this bitch up. If you know where that's from, that's even better. Let's put on our drawing tools right here. Alrighty, so wrapping this bitch up, what do we see? We do see a little bit of continuation of the short-term downside. The key critical ingredient was what we saw yesterday on both the BitMEX and CME chart, the breakage below the descending triangle initiating that mesh move a little bit lower than where we are at right now. Of course, what we did also reference was the 4-hour 200 simple and 200 exponential mean average cross right coming in right here. Anytime that we have seen this in the past, we do see price actions actually sucked up into it, both on the upside and the downside, like we see right here, right here, right here, right here, and right here, and several other times in Bitcoin's past. And where do those two moving averages come in around? Well, they're coming in right around that 17,500 pivot as it is right now. That's also the 382 fib retracement, as we spoke about. And also, if we do reference the CME gap, the gap boys maybe even get vindicated right here, because that's coming in right around the mid $17,000 region as well. And also the daily 21 on the on CME chart here too. So all these areas confluent with each other. And yes, you know, if I had to call it right now, further downside, probably towards the mid $17,000-ish region, with a keen eye on potential bounces at, yeah, 17.9, although I'd say that we've kind of worn out a welcome, on that one already. And if 17.5 does fail, then I would be looking for the last chance for love right around 17.150. Of course, I do remain, I'm technically long-term bullish as long as Bitcoin is putting in putting in higher lows on the daily right now, of which it is. I mean, as long as it's closing above 17,150, it is putting in higher lows. So we are dealing with big, big, big swaps of price action here. And I do want to say once again, you know, at the end of this video, I am bullish on Bitcoin as long as that condition is met. All higher-term timeframes are still bullish. And you're not going to really switch around to me talking about like massive downside targets as long as Bitcoin's closing on higher lows here. That does mean, though, if Bitcoin does start to close below them, well, we can talk about targets to fit, you know, another $2,000-$3,000 lower. So we are at a big pivotal moment right now. But I still go with the former trend until proven otherwise. Short term, however, yes, downside more so implied when we look at momentum oscillators and historic volatility percentile looking like it wants to expand from this region. Yes, I do think that Bitcoin has a little more further downside here to go. And then, you know, whether I'm bullish or bearish, whether this even is bullish or bearish, I would look for a nice balance at around 17.5, and then we'll come back after that and see what's happened. Of course, upside resolution points are still the same thing as well, 19,550, albeit Bitcoin is a little bit far away from that level right now, so not as interesting to talk about, but still, you know, would have the same implied targets that we've been speaking about for the last few weeks towards about 22 or 23,000 and perhaps beyond. With that said, I would like to wish everyone the best of the best once again. Take care, and until next time.